All right, we're going to be reading out of the book of Luke this morning. As a matter of fact, I think we're going to do that first. Luke chapter 22. I titled this morning's message, When God Allows Satan to Be a Sieve. And to be a sieve, S-I-E-V-E.
Sieve.
It's the noun version of the concept of the verb of sifting. And so let me just give you the definition. A sieve is an instrument with a meshed or perforated bottom used for separating coarse from fine parts of loose matter. And the word sift means to put or force through a sieve or to sift. Some of you may not even know what in the world a sifter is or a sieve or whatever the case, but I was telling Sharon with them this morning. I remember back in the day when Mama used to have a couple of them things. You know, I think back then they didn't enrich our flour quite as much, and we had more coarse particles in there, and you'd have to stick it in this thing that had a mesh bottom in it, and they would kind of twirl it around like that. And I can remember whenever she was done, that they'd have big old clumps of stuff in the bottom of it. But nowadays everything's so enriched, you know, you don't have to probably sift too much anymore. But the idea is, the whole point to it was to strain out and to get the smaller particles, which is what you wanted, and to get rid of the larger particles. Spiritually speaking, the idea behind what we're going to be talking about this morning is a separation that's taking place. Just as you separated the fine from the coarse, spiritually there's a separation that's going to be taking place. So we're going to read chapter 22, verses 24 through 34. But just before we do that, I just want you to be aware that the chapter prior to this, Jesus is having a discussion with his disciples, and he's telling them about the coming future, about the kingdom that will be coming. The millennial reign, it describes the millennial reign of Christ, which is a time frame that's going to take place after the rapture of the church. And for that 1,000 years, that's what the word millennium is, it means 1,000 years. For that 1,000 years, Satan and sin are going to be imprisoned in something known as the bottomless pit. And the children of God, those who chose to live for God through the ages, will rule and reign with the Lord for 1,000 years. He was explaining to his disciples that they had a purpose, you know, that they had a purpose and a position, a place in that kingdom. Not only for his disciples then, but also for his disciples of all ages. The truth is told that we have a place and a purpose in the kingdom of God. Amen. Now, in this particular chapter, that was the previous chapter, in this particular chapter right here, within this context of this overall chapter, if you start at the beginning, it talks about the time frame whenever Judas went to the Pharisees and he went to covenant with them for 30 pieces of silver in order to betray Jesus. It also, within this chapter, has the story of the Passover, whenever Jesus and his disciples ate the Passover. So really, the time frame that we're talking about is really the night before it's the night of his betrayal. And the next day he'll be hung on the cross, and then next week is Resurrection Sunday. But so in this particular passage of Scripture, and we'll just kind of talk about some things as we go through, but it says, and there was also a strife among them, talking about the disciples, just bringing in where we are. So this is the night of the Passover. And once again, whenever Jesus ate his Passover meal with his disciples, there was a lot of teaching that was taking place that night. If you go to the Gospel of John, you realize that there was a very long teaching session that took place that night. But in the midst of it, it says there was also a strife among them, which of them should be accounted the greatest. So we've talked about this before in the church. I've actually preached on similar kind of concepts before about the most important night of Jesus' life. And this gives us a little bit of a glimpse of oftentimes what's in our own hearts. Because if the disciples were susceptible to it, then we likely are also, right? That in the biggest night of Jesus' life, when he's about to be betrayed, when he's about to go forward and go to the and be arrested and beaten and hung on a cross, they're more worried about who's going to be the greatest in the kingdom. If you read in some of the other gospel representations, what you see is that it was the sons of thunder. And they were the sons of Zebedee, and they actually came with their mama, and she wanted to know who was going to be able to sit at the Lord's right hand. And so they were very concerned about their position in the kingdom. So all I'm trying to say is that this is the biggest, really the climax of human history. Jesus is about to die on the cross, and his disciples are consumed and concerned about what's going to happen with them rather than being focused on the Lord. And many times the truth could be told about our own lives, maybe not exactly the same way, but the Lord is about doing his work and he's moving forward with his plan. And many times we're concerned and consumed with our own lives and how we're going to be elevated and how things are going to go better for us than rather than having a selfless mindset and being concerned about what's best for the kingdom of God. So it says, which of them would be the greatest? And he said unto them, the kings of the Gentiles exercise lordship over them, and they that exercise authority upon them are called benefactors. Another way to describe the word benefactor would be one who receives honor. He was honorable. So it's talking about people that are elevated in government, whether they be kings or people that receive honor. And these are in the world system, what he's saying is that people that are elevated, like the president, the people that sit on the Senate, people that are CEOs of companies, they receive honor, right? People down here like us, when we see them, we're supposed to honor them, right? But you shall not be so. But he that is greatest among you, let him be as the younger, and he that is chief as he that does serve. And so in other words, the ones who receive honor in God's kingdom aren't the ones who are served, but the ones that serve. Jesus goes on to say, for whether is it greater, he that sits at meat or he that serves? So in other words, he's asking a question. Who is greater in the eyes of men upon this earth? The one that's sitting at the table eating food or the one that's serving the food? And so Jesus goes on to say this. He says, is it not he that sits to eat or he sits at meat? But I am among you as he that serves. You are they which have continued with me in my temptations. What he's saying there, the word temptation really could have been translated as trial. Jesus is saying, as you've been with me, you are my disciples and you've been with me in the midst of my trial. We have to understand the fact that Jesus was being tested. I've said this many times in the past. It's been quite some time since I've said it, but Jesus pronounced himself as the Son of Man. There were even times when he said he was the Son of God. And during his whole ministry, there were times whenever he was tested by the enemy and tested. The enemy used the Pharisees to try to put him to the test. But essentially, he was being put to the test in order to be proven that he was indeed who he said he was, in order to be able to accomplish what the first Adam did wrong. Amen? Jesus had to go through the test as a human being in order to accomplish what the first Adam messed up, so that he could offer up his perfect righteousness on the cross as an acceptable sacrifice to pay the penalty for the sins of humanity. He says, and he explains to them, he says, you are the ones that have continued with me in my temptations. You've been with me through my trial. You've seen how I've reacted to circumstances. And I appoint unto you a kingdom, as my Father has appointed unto me, that you may eat and drink at my table in my kingdom, and sit on thrones judging the 12 tribes of Israel. I don't want to get ahead of myself because I explain some of this a little bit later, but essentially he's saying, what in the world is going on here? You're over here concerned and consumed with what's going to happen and what's going to be best for you. And I'm here to tell you that there's a future kingdom awaiting you, that you are going to be, you're going to have an honored position in that future kingdom. But right now, you're living according to the kingdom of this world. He says, and the Lord said, Simon, Simon. So first we talk about these other disciples, and what they seem to be concerned and consumed about is how they're going to be elevated. Now the Lord turns his attention to Peter. He says, Simon, Simon, behold, Satan has desired to have you, that he may sift you as wheat. That's the title of this morning's message, when God allows Satan to be a sieve, to put you through the sifting process where he's separating certain things in your life. He says, Satan has desired to sift you as wheat, but I have prayed for you, not that you would be taken out of the sieve, not that the sifting would stop, but that your faith fail not.
Right.
Amen? He said, and when you are converted, and the word converted there literally means to be put back on the straight path. It's not necessarily the fact that it was before he was a believer or disciple, but that he would be put back on the straight path. How many of you know that as true believers, each and every one of us at some point in time in our walk with the Lord have ventured off, have veered off, and trust me, whenever you find yourself like Peter is in this situation, God will make sure that a sifting process can take place in order to bring you back to the straight and narrow, in order to bring you back to a place where you realize you cannot do it on your own and you must learn to be dependent upon God. He said, I have prayed for you that your faith fail not. And when you are converted, when you're straightened out, Peter, strengthen your brethren. He said unto him, Lord, I am ready to go with you both into prison and to death. See there, it's just, we got to be able to read between the lines what's going on here. Peter, he thinks a whole lot more highly of himself than what he ought to. He sees himself as very strong. And if you read some of the other gospels of this particular account, he even says the point, they might forsake you. They might run. Not Peter. Peter's going to be right there by your side. I'm going to be ready for prison. I'm going to be ready for death. And don't think that he didn't mean it in his flesh. He meant it in his flesh. And he wasn't scared. You could tell Peter was not scared. He was ready to scrap at a moment's notice. And we're going to see that before it's all said and done. But this is what Jesus said. I tell you, Peter, the cock shall not crow this day before you have thrice denied that you know me. The overall context of this portion of scripture, once again, it connects itself back to the previous chapter that talks about the coming kingdom. Amen. And in this particular one, that time frame, whenever Satan's going to be imprisoned and sin along with him, and it tells us of the fact that God, that the disciples of the Lord who lived for God during this time frame, whenever it required faith to live for God. And the reason it required faith was because the naked eye couldn't see it. The naked eye could. You can sit here if you've talked to anybody about Jesus, and you can sit here and you can talk to them about the Lord all day long. But if there's no light that's shining on the inside of them, they think that you're about the craziest thing, because you can't see it with your physical eyes. Amen. And it's going to be a time whenever man will be rewarded. We're going to be rewarded for serving the Lord. What I mean by that is, just as David's men who met him in the wilderness, they congregated with him in the wilderness. In other words, David was already anointed king, but he wasn't yet appointed king. He wasn't sitting on the throne. There was a whole lot of men, though, that knew that he was the right king, right? And they flocked to him in the wilderness, even when he was on the run from Saul. And in the end, whenever David came to his throne, they were rewarded as his mighty men. The truth be told is that in a spiritual sense, similar for you and I. Similar in the fact that even though the world can't see him with their naked eye, God has said that it requires faith to believe in something that you cannot see. And those that are willing to do it, though, God will reveal himself and make himself known by the power of the presence of his spirit. Amen. When you put faith, and so I used to love the way Lauren Larson used to say it. He'd say that, you know, that it doesn't make any sense to the logical mind. That 2,000 years ago, a 33 and a half year old Jewish man died on two pieces of wood outside a city called Jerusalem. It makes no sense. And that supposedly, when you put your faith in that, it's going to produce eternal life and joy on the inside. Yet, for 2,000 years, when men, women, and child have heard that story and have given their heart and bowed their knee to it, a change takes place. Amen? A change takes place in the heart. And if you have given your life to Christ, you know what I'm talking about, because the Holy Spirit flooded in your heart and he became resident in you, and God has made himself real to you. Amen? And you've experienced the fact that he's real. But those on the outside that have not received Christ, they can't see it. And the struggle will be over on that time, though. Amen? But I need you to know that the struggle that we still face is that we were born originally on this fallen earth. And it's part of who we are. It's still part of who we are. There's a portion of us that's still related to Adam. We're part of Adam's fallen race. The new birth in Christ has allowed the implanted presence of the Holy Spirit of God to be in us, but there are still remnants of the fall in us. The fallen nature still remains in us, and temptations that want to pull us, and that there's these two kingdoms that coexist. There's literally a war many times that is taking place on the inside of the believer. Sometimes we move past these grievous sins that we looked at in the past, and we're like, well, I'm past all of that. Just watch out, Peter. Don't elevate yourself too much. Don't think too highly of yourself, because even though you may have feel like you moved past some of those other sins, the truth be told is that there's still things on the inside of us that the Lord is wanting to sift. He's wanting to allow to be sifted. He's wanting to allow those things to be separated out to reveal to us what's in us. There's a war, right? And the tests that we encounter are related to the choices that we have to make. Choices regarding the fact that we have to reject the kingdom of this world and choose the kingdom of God. These next couple of passages of scripture, if you go to John chapter 12, verses 25 through 31, got a lot of scripture today. These next couple of verses of scripture just point out that there really are two kingdoms. I've used some of them before, but it says in John chapter 12, verses 25 through 31, this is Jesus talking, "He that loves his life shall lose it." Some of the same wording that he was using previously. Servant versus he that's being served. "He that loves his life shall lose it. He that hates his life in this world shall keep it." It's opposite. What is Jesus saying? That you're supposed to kill yourself? No, that's not what he's talking about. He's talking about if you love the life that you have on this world so much so that you refuse to allow yourself to die in the things that you have desire and the things that you want to bring you pleasure in order to embrace the kingdom of God, when the Lord begins to show you that some of those things are contrary to his will, you're going to lose your life. You're going to lose eternal life because of the fact that you held on to this life so hard. That's what the whole parable of the sower is about, and the cares of the world and the thorns and the things of that nature. He says, "If any man serve me, let him follow me, and where I am, there shall also my servant be. If any man serve me, him will my Father honor. Now is my soul troubled, and what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour? For this cause came I unto this hour. Father, glorify your name." What he's saying is, I'm about to go to the cross. I'm about to go to the cross. I'm about to serve the Father. I'm about to do the Father's will. Am I supposed to ask God to help me escape this hour? But this is the whole purpose that I came for.
Amen.
You know, that's an example for you and I. Many times we find ourselves in situations. Now, I'm talking big to you right now, but if you go through it or if I go through it, we're going to probably forget this passage of scripture for a second. And it's really whenever we're going to need to remember it. What I'm trying to say is that so many times we want the Lord to deliver us out of our mess. You remember, Satan has desired to sift you as wheat, but I have prayed, not that you be taken out the sifter, but that your faith fail not. And so many times we're praying, "Lord, deliver me from this mess." And I mean, you can plug in all kinds of things for your own personal life, right? Might not be happy in your marriage. Might not be happy in your workplace. Might not be happy with a lot of different things that could be going on in your life. "Oh, Lord, deliver me from this mess." But the Lord said, "For this very purpose I came here. Lord, glorify your name." Many times we're asking the Lord to take us out of a situation when in reality what God's wanting to do is, through the situation, he is wanting to give himself glory and honor. We're looking to get out, and the Lord's looking to use it as an opportunity to receive glory out of our lives as he does the work that only he can do. Amen? Then came there a voice from heaven saying, "I have both glorified it and will glorify it again." The people, therefore, that stood by and heard it said that it thundered. Others said an angel spoke to him. Jesus answered and said, "This voice came not because of me, but for your sakes." Now, this is the point I wanted to make. Some of these scriptures, whenever I read them, I love them so much just because they're so plain when you really understand what they're saying. And once again, we're talking about two kingdoms right now. I kind of got sidetracked a little bit right there, but whenever I was talking about some of that other stuff that we were just talking about, but we're talking about two kingdoms right now. "Now is the judgment of this world. Now shall the prince of this world be cast out." He's talking about Satan. He's talking about the power that Satan has over this fallen world. If you talk to somebody that knew how to argue anything about the Bible from the other side, they'd say, "Well, look at this scripture right here. God's saying that Satan's cast out, but don't you see the evil in the world? Don't you see all the things?" You and I need to understand something, and we're probably already aware of this. Two kingdoms still coexist on this earth. Amen. There's a kingdom of the enemy, the fallen aspect of the world. There's the kingdom of God. He's alive. It's alive and well, living on the inside of the hearts of believers. Amen. And there's coming a day when it will be manifest for the physical eyes to see upon this earth. Here's another scripture, Ephesians chapter 2, verses 2 through 3. It says, where in time past you walked according to the course of this world. Ephesians 2, verses 2 through 3. Where in time past you walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air. Talking about Satan again. And the influence that he has upon this world. The spirit that works in the children of disobedience. The enemy works in the children of disobedience. God's desiring his children to be the children of obedience, and that the Holy Spirit would work in us. Among whom also we all had our conversation in times past in the lusts of our flesh. We used to be them. Amen? We used to live just like them. We were no better than them. We were born of Adam. Thank God for salvation. Thank God for the Holy Ghost. Amen? That makes us different. Let us not become high-minded and think more of ourselves than what we should. Fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature the children of wrath, even as others. Had God not intervened, we would have also experienced the wrath of God. Colossians 1, 12 through 14. We're just talking about the fact that there's two kingdoms right now. And the fact that we go through trials, and that God is desires to separate that from the old kingdom that still is in us. Amen. And to cause us to move forward towards his kingdom. Colossians 1, 12 through 14. Giving thanks unto the Father, which hath made us meet. In other words, he's made us worthy. We weren't worthy in of ourselves. He made us worthy through Jesus, through what Jesus did at the cross. He's made us meet to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in light. Amen. There's an inheritance that's waiting for you. That's what he was talking to the disciples about. There's a kingdom coming, and you're going to inherit. Amen. And he goes on to say this, of the saints in light, who has delivered us from the power of darkness and has translated us into the kingdom of his dear Son, in whom we have redemption through his blood, even the forgiveness of sins. Previously, we were of the world, we were fallen, we were of the fallen nature, didn't know anything about God, but because Jesus shed his blood and we heard the gospel and put our faith in that, we were redeemed, purchased back from the kingdom of darkness. And through that, a spiritual translation took place. I don't know why I just thought of this, because I never really watched Star Trek too much when I was a kid, but you remember that little beam me up, Scotty, how fast that would happen? In the spiritual realm, the day that you got saved, basically that's what happened. You were translated from one spot to another spot because the kingdom of God now became resident on the inside of your heart. Amen? Amen. And so you were now purchased out of the previous kingdom. These passages point out the fact that there are undoubtedly two kingdoms. The kingdom of the prince of this evil age, which exists currently on this earth, and the kingdom of God, which exists in the hearts of God's followers. Unfortunately, in the first passage that we read when we started, the disciples are behaving according to the pattern of the present kingdom, the fallen realm into which man is born through his first birth in Adam. It's either selfishness, like the first one said, who's going to be the greatest in your kingdom? Who's going to get the seat at your right hand? Or it's dependence on self, like Peter. They might fail you, but I will never fail you. I'll go to prison for you. I will die for you. Both of them, thinking more highly of themselves than what they ought to, maybe in different circumstances or different ways, but it's all the same. Elevation of self instead of denial of self. The blessings of the coming kingdom are for the true followers of God. There will be many on that day that will say, Lord, Lord, but didn't we do this? Jesus says it right there in the passage in Luke 22, verse 38, that we've read already. He said, you are they which have continued with me in my temptations. You've been with me through this trial, through this testing experience. You've been with me all along the way. They've been by his side and he's endured his testing, but really for them, the tests are just beginning. For the disciples, the tests are just beginning. Like the original disciples, you and I remain in this current order or the kingdom of the world, which operates different than the kingdom of God. Unfortunately, much of this world remains in us. And part of the process of God getting it out is through testings, through the test revealings, and through the revealings
failures, sometimes failures are part of the process. Come on, somebody, don't look at me through your religious eyes and you're down your religious nose. Some of the tests result in failure.
Yeah.
Sometimes it's big failure, sometimes it's small failure. Sometimes it's just the way I've told y'all the story before. Man, sometimes I pray, Lord, I wish I could, my heart would be that soft again. I hate to admit it to you, but sometimes I feel like my heart's gotten hard through the years. Is it okay to be transparent? Mm-hmm. I can remember one time I was getting ready to go on vacation, and whenever where I work in this clinic, we used to use these little clothespins, colored clothespins to do some like nonverbal communication. We got us a flag system now, dude. It looks so much nicer. But anyway, green means that I need to see the patient, and like blue means they need shots. So I was the last patient of the day. I saw the patient. I'm getting ready to go to Destin, Florida, man. I'm fired up. I got a week off. I'm so excited. I walk out. I get in my car. I get a phone call. Matt, you left a patient in room one. Well, whenever I get back up there, the person that put the patient in the room forgot to change the clip. And so I just walked in there and I like threw my keys on the desk. Well, who did that? Blah, blah, blah. And you know, one of my nurses, she's retired now, she was standing there, and you know, it wasn't even really her fault. Even if it was her fault, I don't know if I was supposed to act like that. Yeah. And so I did my thing, I saw my patient, and I left. I got about halfway down the hallway, and the Lord said, "That's how you leave it, to go on vacation?" And I was like, I thought in my mind, you want me to go back in there, and you want me to apologize to her. He's like, if you still want my presence with you, that's what you need to do. And so I did. I went in there. It was real simple. I went in there and I said, you know, Miss Judy, it wasn't your fault. I mean, and not, even if it would have been, the way I handled it was wrong, and I apologize for the way that I acted. She said, oh, man, no big deal. I mean, it was that easy. Just humble yourself a little bit every now and then. Amen. You know what I'm saying? And I guess I just thought of that real quick. And I guess I'm just trying to say that. So oftentimes, that's just an example of one little failure. The reason I wanted to point that out, because it doesn't seem like that big of a deal, but it was a failure. I know it's not like a big failure. Sometimes we experience big failures. The point, though, is the same. There's always something that the Lord's tweaking. He's always touching and showing us, right? Allows a test to take place because he allows the enemy sometimes to be a sieve in our life, to cause a sifting to take place, to separate that which is not of the Lord from that which is of the Lord, so that you and I can come to the place where we learn dependence upon Him. And each and every trial that takes place, there's oftentimes failures that reveal to us what is in us, that cause us to come to the place that we realize, you know what happens in that situation? Lord, I need you. Lord, I need you. I can't do it on my own. I can sit here and think that I am independent and that I'm strong, but the reality is that without you moving in my life, I am going to mess this thing up. I'm not going to represent your kingdom the way that I'm supposed to. Lord, I need you to do a work on the inside of my life. You can be sure that there are two kingdoms that coexist on this earth and that they're against each other.
Right.
Amen? John chapter 7, verses 3 through 7. These next passages of scripture in the Gospel of John just show us that these two kingdoms are against each other. Jesus says, his brethren therefore said unto him, so this is he's up in Galilee with his actual brothers, and his brothers say to him, depart from here, go into Judea, that your disciples also may see the works that you do. For there is no man that doeth anything in secret, and he himself seeks to be known openly. If you do these things, show yourself to the world. For neither did his brethren believe in him. Then Jesus said unto them, my time is not yet come, but your time is always ready. See, they weren't believers in Jesus yet. Jude and James later on become pillars in the church. But at this point in time, they don't believe him. They don't believe he's really the Son of God. You grew up in the house with us. If you do these things, show yourself to the world, for neither did his brethren believe in him. Then Jesus said unto them, my time is not yet come, but your time is always ready. Why? The world can't hate you, but me it hates. They can't hate you because you're a part of it. You're still part of it. You're rubbing shoulders with the world. They're never going to hate you because you're one with them. But me it hates. Why? Because I testify of it. I give a witness and a testimony against the world. What I say is that its works thereof are evil. And so therefore, the world hates me. The main point that I'm just trying to make with this passage, two kingdoms exist. two kingdoms still are fighting for internally for our soul. The flesh lusts against the spirit. The spirit lusts against the flesh. There's victory in Christ. Amen. There's victory at Calvary. Whenever you keep your faith in Christ and what He did for you at the cross, the Holy Spirit runs to your aid. The Holy Spirit gives you victory. But guess what? There's still the reality that each and every day we're walking this thing out and we're finding ourselves in the sieve. We're finding ourselves in the situations and the battle still continues to rage. Because let me tell you something, the enemy will not give up easy on your soul. He wants to drag his men and he wants to destroy the faith of God's believers. And let me tell you, that's the whole story of what's going on in Peter's life right now. Satan wants to sift him and Satan wants to separate Peter from his faith. John 15, 18 through 20. If the world, John, let me slow down. John 15, verse 18. John 15, verse 18. Sandy's on it though. Right, Sandy? John, but I like the fact that people like old, like pages. So I'm going to slow down. John 15, verses 18 through 20. If the world hates you, you know that it hated me before it hated you. If you were of the world would love his own. But because you are not of the world, but I have chosen you out of the world, therefore the world hates you. Remember the word that I said unto you, the servant is not greater than his Lord. If they have persecuted me, they will also persecute you. If they have kept my saying, they will keep yours also. These two passages of Scripture remind us that the world is not a friend of God. When its evil is exposed, it will respond through hate. One idea that we've already mentioned to be drawn from today's message is that if our king was tested, that's what we talked about. If our king was tested, certainly we should also expect the same. We should expect to be put to the test to see whether we are truly living according to the kingdom of this world or the kingdom of God. Essentially, it's what Paul asked. He asked, are we really in the faith? 2 Corinthians 13, verse 5. That's what the testing is about. I said it earlier. The test reveals things. Sometimes through failures, shows us what's in us, but it gives us the opportunity to go to the Lord when we recognize and say, Lord, I need you to remove this. Amen. 2 Corinthians 13:5 says, examine yourselves whether you be in the faith. Prove your own selves. Know ye not that your own selves, how that Jesus Christ is in you, except you be reprobates. In other words, a reprobate, I like this word right here. I've used it a lot to do a teaching. There's a word in the Greek called dokimas. And a dokimas was a person who would exchange money. And so back in those days, remember how I told y'all before in the past that they would clip coins? It's kind of like, I hate to use this as an analogy, but it's the best one I know. Like a drug dealer cuts drugs, and y'all might not know what I'm talking about, but like, they'll take, if they got an ounce of cocaine, they'll take like a fourth of an ounce out, and they'll stick some other junk in it. That's what they did back in the days with these coins. They clipped the coins, and they'd keep the shavings till they had enough to make another coin. Well, a dokimas was a person who had been proven to do legitimate business. You could trust him. You could go to him and you could say, you could make sure that your exchange of money was proper because he had a reputation of being a proven one. In the New Testament, the word is oftentimes used as believers who have been proven by God to really be the true followers of God. In this particular case for reprobates, the word right here, the letter is in front of an A dokimas. The word A means without. Okay, whenever you add the prefix A, it means without. So essentially what it's saying is that you're going to be found to be an unproven one. Test yourself whether you really be in the faith. For though don't you know that Christ be in you unless you're an adokimos, unless you're an unproven one. In other words, we're back to the idea of the testing. We're back to the idea of the sift. We're back to the idea of the separation of things and God proving us through the midst of the trial whether to be proven to be what it was that we said that we were going to be. Hey, welcome to Christianity. This is going to be a lifelong process, amen, till you see the Lord. Amen. Praise God, there's going to be some victories of your past and you're going to be so happy that you got rid of those things, amen. But there's some other things that you're going to find out through the trial, through the test, in the sift,
that God still wants to deal with. The title of today's message corresponds to this idea, because a sieve separates. Satan wants to separate Peter from his faith, but God always wants to separate us from our sin, moving us further away from our first birth in the old kingdom and moving us closer to him in our new birth and the new kingdom, essentially putting us to the test, proving us to be a dokimos, amen, a one who's been proven in character and in faith. In the first part passage that we read, some of the other disciples are worried about who will sit on the throne with him, but I want to focus on Peter. He's so confident in himself. He sees himself as so strong, especially when compared to the other disciples. The coming kingdom is prepared for those who worked on building God's kingdom, not their own. The coming kingdom is prepared for those who trusted in God's strength, not their own. Amen. The first disciples, they're over there trying to build up their, who's going to sit at your right hand? Who's going to be the greatest? Amen. And in Peter's case, he's trusting in his own strength. And while our focus this morning is on Peter, it must be understood that each of us, like the disciples, have thought more highly of ourselves than what we should have. We thought that maybe compared to others, we were more faithful. And while we might have not said it with our own mouths, we thought it with our own hearts. We thought that we might deserve more blessing than others. I know I've thought that before. I hate to admit it, but I look at other people's lives and I'm thinking to myself, boy, I'm doing good. Look at this person. Why they got blessed like that? Why didn't I get blessed like that? Furthermore, like Peter, each of us at some point in our walk have thought we were stronger than what we really were, not realizing that the reality was completely opposite. We saw ourselves as strong when we were really weak because we had come to a place of self-dependence. But the kingdom of God is for those who learn dependence on the Lord. Amen. The sifting of Peter took place during Jesus' arrest and Peter's response afterwards. This is a period of time that probably took at least about a month. I mean, it's hard for me to prove exactly how long it took. And what I mean by that is that there was... The main point I want to make is that there was some time that went from the night of Jesus' arrest to the time that he turned his back. And what he said was, I go fishing. We've preached that before. That in the original Greek language, it's not just a simple fishing trip. There's nothing wrong with going to the camp and go fishing. What Peter was talking about was that he was going back to his former way of life. He felt the condemnation and the guilt of what he had done, how he had denied the Lord, and the enemy was using that as an opportunity. That was the sifting. At least that's what I see when I look at Peter's life. The sift, whenever Jesus tells him beforehand, Satan has asked permission. He desires to have you that he might sift you as wheat. He wants to separate you from your faith. But my prayer for you is that in the midst of the sifting, that your faith fail not. And so there's a process that takes place from the time of the failure to the time of the revelation when the Lord brings restoration. And it's in the midst of that time frame that some stuff's going on spiritually. And what's happening is that the enemy is trying to convince you that you're unworthy because of the failure that you've done. However it is that you feel like the enemy tries to make you feel like you failed God, whatever it is that the enemy tries to speak to you or whisper to you in your ear, he tries to convince you that you are unworthy of the presence of God, and he's trying to sift you, and he's ultimately trying to separate you from your faith. But God, like Jesus said, I have prayed that your faith fail not. And when you're converted, when you put back on the straight and narrow, when you turn back from the veering off which you had previously done, what I need you to do is, I need you to strengthen your brethren, Peter. I need you to quit thinking as highly of yourself as what you ought to and remain focused on what this kingdom is all about. That the greatest of this kingdom isn't he who's sitting at the table and eating and being served, but instead it's the one that's serving. I have showed you that example. If we read Mark chapter 14, verses 37 through 72. Mark 14, verses 37 through the end. We're just going to kind of talk about this occurrence real quick on the night. Excuse me, that Peter was, it's all started when he was put in the sift or the sieve. This is in the Garden of Gethsemane after they had eaten the Passover that we had talked about. And it says, and he cometh, talking about Jesus, and he finds them sleeping and says unto Peter, Simon,
Sleepest thou? Couldest not thou watch 1 hour? Watch ye and pray, lest ye enter into temptation. The spirit truly is ready, but the flesh is weak. And again he went away and prayed and spoke the same words. And when he returned, he found them asleep again, for their eyes were heavy. Neither wist they what to answer him. And he cometh the third time and says unto them, sleep on now and take your rest. It is enough. The hour is come. Behold, the Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Rise up, let us go. Lo, he that betrayeth me is at hand. Well, I don't know if you felt that right there, but I just felt it. You felt that? In his voice. It's okay. You can go ahead and get your rest because the time is. I just needed you just for that little bit of period of time right there just to pray with me as I was going through this. But it's here now. The betrayal has taken place. And immediately while he yet spoke, comes Judas, one of the 12, and with him a great multitude with swords and staves from the chief priests and the scribes and the elders. And he that betrayed him had given them a token, saying, whomsoever I shall kiss, that same is he. Take him and lead him away safely. And as soon as he was come, he goeth straightway to him and saith, Master, Master, and kissed him. And they laid their hands on him and took him. And one of them that stood by drew a sword and smote a servant of the high priest and cut off his ear. Now, if you read in other gospels, many of us know that was Peter. Peter pulled his sword out and, yay, take it, my Lord, and cut his ear off. His name was Malchus. He was a servant of the high priest. Just cut his ear right off. And what did Jesus have to do? He picked it up and he healed him. He said, put your sword in the scabbard, Peter. So don't think that Peter didn't mean business when he said, Lord, I'll go with you to prison, Lord. And wasn't that Peter? What? Peter was a tough dude. But toughness isn't going to get you through in the spiritual battle. Amen. They laid their hands on him and took him, and one of them that drew a sword and smote off the servant of the high priest cut off his ear. Verse 48. Jesus answered and said unto them, are you come out as against a thief with swords and with staves to take me? I was daily with you in the temple teaching, and you took me not, but the scriptures must be fulfilled. And they all forsook him and fled. Talking about his disciples. They said that Jesus said, told him, he said, they're going to strike the shepherd and the sheep are going to be scattered. As soon as they grabbed him, they all flew off in different directions. And there followed him a certain young man having a linen cloth cast about his naked body, and the young man laid hold on him. And he left the linen cloth and fled from them naked. Many scholars believe that that was actually Mark right there, that Mark, because he wrote the gospel, that he talks about the fact that he was there. I mean, there's no way to really prove that. And they led Jesus away to the high priest, and with him were assembled all the chief priests and the elders and the scribes. And Peter followed him afar off, even into the palace of the high priest. And he sat with the servants and warmed himself at the fire. And the chief priests and all the council sought for witness against Jesus to put him to death, and found none. For many bear false witness against him, but their witness agreed not together. And there arose certain and bear false witness against him, saying, we heard him say, I will destroy this temple that is made with hands, and within 3 days I will build another made without hands. But neither so did their witness agree together. And the high priest stood up in the midst and asked Jesus, saying, answerest thou nothing? What is it which these witnesses against thee, that witness against thee? But he held his peace and answered nothing. Again, the high priest asked him and said unto him, art thou the Christ, the Son of the Blessed? And Jesus said, I am. And you shall see the Son of Man sitting on the right hand of power and coming in the clouds of heaven. Then the high priest ripped his clothes. That's another word for tore. He tore his clothes and saith, what need we any further witnesses? Ye have heard the blasphemy. What think ye? And they all condemned him to be guilty of death. And some began to spit on him and to cover his face and to buffet him, which means to strike or hit him, and to say unto him, prophesy. And the servants did strike him with the palms of their hands. And as Peter was beneath in the palace, there cometh one of the maids of the high priest. And when she saw Peter warming himself, she looked upon him and said, and thou also was with Jesus of Nazareth. But he denied, saying, I know not, neither understand I what you say. And he went out into the porch, and the cock crew. And a maid saw him again and began to say to them that stood by, this is one of them. And he denied it again. And a little after, they that stood by said again to Peter, surely thou art one of them, for thou art a Galilean, and thy speech agrees thereto. But he, in other words, your accent, you can't hide it from us. We know you're with him. But he began to curse and to swear, saying, I know not this man of whom you speak. And the second time the cock crew, and Peter called to mind the word that Jesus said unto him, before the cock crow twice, shalt thou deny me thrice. And when he thought thereon, he wept. So we can see that this is the beginning of the putting being put into the sift. This is the beginning of the trial that Peter would go through. Immediately, remorse has settled in. He's gotten a revelation of how he failed the Lord and how he wasn't really near as strong as what he thought he was. Now, I will tell you that whenever we talk about things, because I'm about to give you a little bit of practical information, but none of the things that I'm going to speak of, these are just common occurrences that take place in the life of believers when they find themselves in a sifting situation. But we all know that victory doesn't come through any of the things that I'm about to talk about. But that instead, these really serve more kind of maybe as a mirror of what you could recognize in your own life if you're in the midst of a sifting situation. Pitfalls that oftentimes happen to believers when they find themselves in these circumstances. But victory is always the same. While it may seem simple when you draw this stuff up on the board, the reality of it is that sometimes knowing something intellectually or cognitively doesn't mean that you've truly had a revelation from the Holy Spirit, where the Holy Spirit floods your heart and helps you to truly understand how God gives victory. Amen? And what I always repeatedly talk about whenever we draw this on the board is the fact that the old man born of Adam is born in sin, born bound in sin. One of the things that we talked about so far this morning was the fact that that the old nature is still in us, and that there's remnants of the old kingdom in us, and that God is desiring to pull it out. That's the process of sanctification. We talked about that a little bit last week, right? But what we need to understand is that when it comes to victory, the old man born of Adam had no victory. He was born in sin, born of Adam. He didn't understand the things of God. He didn't really, on a perpetual basis, have any help from God. Not to say that God never saved his life. Not to say that God never spared him. Not to say that God never called him. Amen. But before he gave his heart to the Lord, he didn't have the help from God. But when you heard the gospel and you put your faith in it, it requires faith, right? When you put your faith in the gospel, what Jesus, who he was and what he did for you at the cross, then a miracle took place. In God's mind, you died. The old man that was born of Adam died with Jesus at the cross. If you could imagine yourself, we got all kind of cool special effects nowadays, you know, moving backwards in time 2,000 years, and you became one with Jesus at the cross. In God's mind, that's what happened. You died with him. You were buried with him in the tomb. And guess what? Just as he resurrected from the dead, you too have been given a new life. And that's what happens spiritually. And now you're in him. The divine nature is implanted in you. And the Holy Spirit has a desire to go to work for you. Has a desire to help you, to be your comforter, to be your helper. That's what the word means. He wants to be your helper. Everything that the Holy Spirit does in the life of the believer is predicated on one concept. This right here. If it weren't for this, the Holy Spirit, he doesn't go to work for you. Because sin still stands in the way between Adam and God. There's a barrier before conversion called sin that stands in the way of the presence of God. But because of the cross, because of your faith in that, because now you've been called righteous because you've been given Jesus' righteousness, your continued faith in him and what he did daily. And we're not just talking about now I get to go to heaven. We're talking about daily when I'm in the sieve, when I'm going through the trial, when I'm in the process, when the enemy's trying to separate me from my faith, when I'm in the battle, that I need to understand that as I keep my faith and knowing, Jesus, you already did it. You're my source. You're my strength, and because of what you did and my faith in what you did, I know that the Holy Spirit is the power that I need. He's the one that's going to get me through this. He's the one that's going to strengthen me. Lord, I submit myself to your strength and to your power. Amen. That's the way to victory. But what I do want to show you right here is that in this passage of Scripture we just read, some common things that happen. Number one, point number one, many times when you find yourself in a sieve, you will find, you may realize that there were some things that were going on in your life that had kind of changed to where your focus wasn't as much spiritually as what it should have been, right? Amen. Number one, you weren't spiritually sober. 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 7. Just bear with me. We're getting to near the end. 1 Peter 4, 7. And then we're going to go to 1 Peter 5, 8. It says, "But the end of all things is at hand. Be ye therefore sober and watch unto prayer." I've said this many times in the church, but and many of you may not be familiar with it, but if you start looking on the internet and you look at different churches, you know, there was a big movement even back in the 80s with the Word of Life people, and they all wanted to be drunk in the Spirit. Oh, let's get drunk in the Spirit. And they're just flopping around, just giggling and laughing and all this kind of stuff, carrying on and everything. And people like were drawn to it because it's like a lot of times people sad, you know, and it's like, well, why did I get laughed like that? But the Bible says be sober. It doesn't tell us to be drunk.
Amen.
It talks about the book of Acts, but that's a whole other story. I'm not even getting into that right now. The Bible repeatedly tells us to be sober.
Amen.
Verse 1 Peter 5, 8 says, "Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walketh about seeking whom he may devour." He desires to devour. In Mark 14:37, which is part of what we just read, I look at the fact that they were sleeping as a lack of spiritual sobriety. It says, once again, "And he cometh and finds them," Mark 14:37, "sleeping, and says unto Peter, Simon, sleepest thou? Could you not watch 1 hour? Watch you and pray, lest you enter into temptation. The spirit truly is ready, but the flesh is weak." The Lord is definitely telling us right there that you need to have a life of prayer. You need to be aware of the fact that the enemy is out there and he's seeking whom he may devour, and you need to be mindful of spiritual things. Peter and the rest of the disciples had become tired and were letting their guard down. And you know, I got to tell you that it's true. That part of the story describes physical exhaustion. There's no question about that. I mean, they're probably physically exhausted. Who knows how much sleep that they've had. And Jesus' question to them signifies spiritual importance. Could you not watch 1 hour? In this life, we have to contend with both spiritual and physical matters, right? When I say physical, I mean eating, sleeping, working, taking care of our families. But we better make sure that we're staying awake and that we're staying sober. The point that I'm trying to make is this. There's a real life out there to live, but many times we get so caught up in it, and hey, I can raise my hand and tell you that I can do it too. We get so caught up in it that we forget to be spiritually sober.
Amen.
And be spiritually minded, and to have a life of prayer, and to have a life of study, to seek the things of God. Amen? And I got to tell you that we become so focused on the practical that we forget the spiritual. This is what Jesus said. We need to learn how to trust in the Lord. Amen?
Amen.
You got to eat? Okay, the Lord can feed you.
Amen.
You got to have some clothes on your back? Guess what?
The Lord
can clothe you. What are you talking about, preacher? I got to get out and work. Yeah, you got to work. The Lord said, the Word of God says, he who doesn't work is worse than an infidel. But you don't have to consume yourself and think that all the pressure's on you to figure it out.
Amen.
Amen? Matthew 6, 25 through 27 talks about that. Matthew 6, 25 through 27 says, "Therefore I say unto you, take no thought for your life, what you shall eat or what you shall drink, nor yet for your body, what you shall put on. Is not the life more than meat or food? The body more than raiment, which is clothing? Behold the fowls of the air, for they sow not, neither do they reap, nor gather into barns. Yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much better than they? Which of you, by taking thought, can add 1 cubit unto his stature?" The word thought means
kind of like the idea of stress. It's not just that you're thinking about it, but you're like worried about it. And I got to tell you that that's number one. We got to be spiritually sober. We got to be spiritually awake. We can't get so consumed in the physical and how we're going to operate and fix everything that we don't allow God to trust it. Amen? Amen. Now, I realize that when we're going through it, it's not always easy. But sometimes we just got to be reminded. Amen? Lord, I'm trusting you. Sometimes I don't even know what that's like anymore. You know, it's bad, but I'm trusting you. I believe you're going to get me through this thing. Amen? Number two, operating in the new kingdom the way we always did it before. Can't do that. When you're in the sieve, you can't just handle your business the way you always did it before. You can't just walk up in the place and say, you know what, if I want to have a bad attitude, I will. I'll throw my keys on the counter. And I'll talk to you any old way that I want to. You can't handle your business the way that you used to handle your business. You were bought with a price. Amen. Amen. It doesn't mean you're never going to fail. Doesn't mean you're never going to mess up. But you need to be reminded and you need to be aware that when you did it, opposite of the way that the Lord would have had you to do it, that wasn't the way you were supposed to do it. You can't just operate the way that you always did before. Mark 14, verse 46 through 47. They laid their hands on him and took him, and one of them that stood by drew a sword and smote a servant of the high priest and cut off his ear. Peter's just handling his business like he always has before. Just doing things exactly the way that he always did it. I can remember one time we preached, and I thought that was a pretty good message when we did the Gospel of John. And Jesus had told them that they were going to be called to speak the word to people. And here Peter goes and cuts off the organ of hearing to somebody. And I was thinking to myself, because we were talking about offending people. It kind of goes along with this little concept right here. Doing things the way you always did it before. We want to be witnesses, right? We want to be witnesses for the kingdom. But yet, we go around offending people. And what we basically did at that point was we cut off their organ of hearing. They don't hear us no more. They ain't going to lend us our ear. We just took it from them. And they're not going to want to hear what it is that we have to say. We can't just do business the way that we always did business before. What Peter's doing, though, is that he's actually trying in his own strength, the only way that he knows how, through his own wisdom, to accomplish or to stop this situation from happening. And many times we do the same. People would say, well, that's not my problem, preacher. I don't have a problem with violence. Okay, well, what is your problem? Amen. I mean, there is one. Yeah. It may not be that one. Is it when you're lonely, do you jump into a new relationship? I mean, that maybe that doesn't go for anybody in here, but y'all know people that I'm talking about. Every time we get lonely, you know, and people learn to live. That's one of the hardest things for single women when they give their heart to Jesus to get away from. For them to get away from being if they've been in a relationship with men all of their lives, it's one of the hardest things for them to get away from. Because they've learned to become dependent in that particular relationship. And I'm not saying men don't do the same thing for different reasons, but you get the point that I'm making. Do you make bad decisions and then ask others to get you out? I think we've all done that before, right? Make bad decisions and then, oh Lord, now I'm in a bind. Sometimes it's beyond our control. I'm not trying to say that it's always our fault. That's not what I'm trying to get at. As a matter of fact, sometimes we try our best to use wisdom and to save and to plan for problems, but things happen, you know. But the point that I'm trying to make is some people constantly find themselves making bad decisions, and then I don't even know if they realize it or not, but they want somebody else to bail them out. And I'm not saying that I've never asked that. I'm like, Daddy, send me $200. I'm in a bind. But at some point in time, we got to come to the place where we're not operating in our own wisdom and our own strength. Do you make decisions about things based on your wisdom instead of praying and asking God to lead you? I think that that's an issue that probably each and every one of us, right? Sometimes like something happens and it just seems like the right thing to do. I just need to go ahead and move forward. This is how I'm going to fix this situation. But we never really stop and ask the Lord his opinion in this circumstance. Lord, if it's your will, then I pray that you would give me a peace about it, that you'd open up the right doors, right? But if it's not your will, Lord, please show me that it's not you. And give me the grace that I need to hear the word no. Amen. Number three, who do you keep company with? I thought, you know, you might feel like I'm stretching a little bit right here, but in Mark 14:50, well, really through that whole scripture, well, in Mark 14:50 it says they all forsook him and they fled. the disciples ran in different directions, right? In Mark 14:54, it says, Peter followed him afar, even unto the palace of the high priest, and there he sat with the servants, and he warmed himself at the fire. That's where he denied the Lord the first time. Then there comes another time he denies the Lord again. But each time, I'm not going to read all the passages of Scripture again, but each time what I want you to know is that Peter was around other people. I don't think that I'm reaching too far. I mean, I might be making it happen too quick, but the point that I'm trying to make is this. He wasn't with his fellow believers anymore. He was finding himself around in a crowd of people that were against Jesus, is the point that I'm trying to make, right? And whenever he finds himself in a crowd of people that are against Jesus, he begins to fear persecution. He fears persecution. He fears the fact that he's connected to Jesus, and he doesn't want to admit it. And I can tell you this, that there is a strength and that there is power in Christian fellowship in the sense that God's in the midst of you. Amen. Whenever two or more are gathered, he's right there with them. And whenever we find ourselves in the sieve, the last thing we're supposed to do is flee our brothers and sisters in the Lord and connect ourselves to people who are not of like-minded faith.
Correct.
Right? And so because of the fact that, once again, they're probably going to be persecutors of the Lord. They're not going to see Jesus the same way that we do. And we're going to have a tendency to shrink back instead of stand strong. That's typically what happens. Now, I'm not saying it's always the case. There's a lot of people that are so bold for Jesus that they, you know what I'm saying, they thrive on things like that. But typically, that's not what happens. Typically, people are influenced by those around them. There's a Matthew 18:20, and I'm actually closing with this. That's actually, I just quoted the scripture, really. It says, for where two or three are gathered together in my name, there am I in the midst of them. Amen. The Lord desires, we need his presence. Praise God. There's a power of Christian fellowship in being with like-minded believers. The Lord promises to be with us. The last thing we should do is find ourselves away, once again, from our Christian fellowship and around people that are unbelievers in the world. You know, this morning's message was about the sieve, about the sifting. What we need to be reminded is that the enemy wants to separate us from our faith, but that God, in the midst of that, wants to show us the things that are in us, to remove them from us, so that we can continue to move closer to the things of God and the kingdom of God. Amen.